Good morning. Good morning.
Station yourself.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Hirata Community Church. Well, today is a Sunday, the 17th of March. Well, it's St. Patrick's Day for people from Ireland, Irish people. What's that? Greetings from Wales. St. Patrick's Day. Did you know St. Patrick was from Wales? He's a Welsh originally. Yeah. And went to Ireland to spread the gospel. See, age of a saint. Well, I'm not Welsh, as you can see. But I live here long enough. So I would say, on behalf of Welsh people, you're welcome. Well, it is, isn't it? See, it wasn't for St. Patrick. Oh, never mind. Well, important thing is, St. Patrick worked for God. You see, he's our big boss. And he's the one give us such a blessing, joy and peace and all those things. And so, well, let's pray and thank God. God said, come into his presence with thanksgiving. So thank you, Lord. You are the God Almighty who provides us of the everything and even more. All the blessings, prosperity. And Lord, most of all, Lord Jesus, you made us a way to come to the Father. So we got so many things we want to thank you for. So that's why we are here to praise you and worship you, to give you thanks. So let's hand over to worship group and everybody stand up and then worship God today.
The God who wins, we worship the God who ever lives.
We were the beggars. That's where I'm strong, in your presence. see the sound of angels singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Let us see the saints and elders gathering in worship round your throne. Let us hear, let us hear the sound. Thank you.
Thank you, God. Ah, He's so good. Good, isn't He? Well, praise God, those who are healed. Brilliant. Well, first of all, I have to say, God is good. Please keep, all the time, keep that in mind, please. God is good. Well, today, do you know, I was talking to Roy this morning before the service start. When we become Christian, or when we became a Christian, do you remember those younger days? Yeah. I know some of you, you know, it's long, long, long time ago, far, far away in the galaxy. But anyway. Do you remember when you became a Christian, you didn't know anything about Christianity much? You know, and basically you are told, you did what you are told. You know, and you believed everything. Well, I don't know, pastors or ministers or whatever was saying, doing things. And then when you get matured, you started questioning it about things. And this is what it is. You know, that's what we are trying to do. You know, interesting, I was reading the Acts chapter 17 the other day. Interesting, when Paul went to a place called Beera, a little town in the Greece. And people, you know, as the custom of that time, Paul went into synagogue to talk to Jews and converted Jews from Greek people. And they are very open-minded and eager to listen to what Paul says. So Paul preached about Jesus according to the scriptures and prophets and stuff. And he told Jesus is the Messiah, just as the scripture says. Yeah? Do you know those people in the Beera? They didn't take that in straight away. They actually went into the scriptures, looked hard to make sure what Paul was saying is right. Do you know, they didn't take that Paul's message straight away. They wanted to make sure that's true. You know, this is something like this. When we became a Christian, we just believed what the people told you because you didn't know. But now, I would say, go to the scripture. Ask Holy Spirit to make sure what you hear is right and true. And today, I'm going to give you a word. Title is The Truth About Holiness. And, you know, if you have got a little question in your mind, Please go to the scripture and find out what I am saying right or not. And if it's not, please come back to me and tell me, Goichi, you're teaching us something wrong, but make sure you back that with the scripture, not just what you believe from the traditions. And I say this for the any other teaching or preaching from this place in the Claudia Community Church, you do the same. Yeah? Please, make sure you go back and find out. And make sure we are telling the truth. Well, as I said, holiness, or be holy, is a very Christian word, isn't it? I give you the scripture. 1 Peter, chapter 1, verse 16. The Peter is quoting from Leviticus 19:2. It says, be holy because I am holy. This I bit is the Lord God Almighty. Yeah? Please keep that in the back of your mind. You know, holiness, as I said, very common. Well-used word in Christianity, isn't it? You know, you've heard a preacher. Have you heard a preacher saying, because you're Christian, you have to live a holy life. You must be holy. Yeah? Quote in the verse, be holy as the Lord is holy. Or, you might have heard someone said sarcastically, says, oh, you think you are holier than rest of us, eh? 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 You know, generally what they meant by saying holy is being sinless or pure or righteous, isn't it? The preacher is saying, you are the Christian. You have to live the sinless life, pure life. And those people who are sarcastically saying, you think you are holier than we are, well, the rest of us, it means you think you're more righteous than we are. That's what they meant, didn't they? You see, that's a general perception of holiness, of being holy, sinless, pure, and righteous, generally. That's what the people use that word for. See? And when you hear that, you know, like you can actually read those in the Christian books, the commentaries and preaching, and it said holiness means being sinless, the pure and the righteous. Or even some of the books says perfection unto God, you know. And then you look at yourselves, you know, or let's include me, we look at ourselves and see our shortfalls, you know, weaknesses, and feel, I'm not the holy enough. I'm not the righteous enough. I'm sinful. You know, I'm actually Christian. You start questioning, or am I truly saved even? You know, you start feeling guilt and shame, powerlessness, depression and doubt. Have you ever felt that when you heard someone mention holiness? I did. Oh, yeah. Said, I'm not holy enough to be going to church. I'm not pure enough to preach the gospel. I'm not righteous enough to tell people off from pulpit like this. People. Then, I went to have a look at the scripture. Places the mentioning holiness and be holy. And I found out there's something different about what the Word of God says about holiness than what the people meant the holiness means. So let's have a look what the scriptures say. How about this? Holy God. Have you heard the phrase? God is holy. He is holy. You know, Isaiah 6 and Revelation 4, it says, angels singing in heaven said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Does it mean God is sinless, pure, and righteous? Of course he is sinless, pure, and righteous. That's why he's called God, isn't it? But I believe that God doesn't need that kind of adjective. He is a sinless God. He is a pure God. He is a righteous God. I don't think he needs that to describe himself. God means all that, isn't it? It's just like we are saying, that's the sweet sugar, or that's a salty salt. You don't say that, don't you? It's salt is salt, it's sugar is sweet, so you don't say that. But by saying Holy God, it's be like that, isn't it? You know, that ship is boat-like. That stallion's horse-like. You know, strange, isn't it? Holy God. How about this? God's holy people, a holy nation. You know, Israelites were called by God as his holy people, a holy nation. Yeah? You've read that in scriptures. Doesn't mean that Israelites were sinless and pure and righteous. Well, look at the history. Look at the Bible. They sinned against God and rebelled against God. You know, if they are that righteous, they've never crucified the Messiah, didn't they? Holy, but they are still called holy people. How about this? The burning bush where Moses met God. When Moses encountered the burning bush, he heard God speaking through the bush and said, God said to Moses, take off your shoes, for this is holy ground. Does God mean this place is sinless, pure, or even righteous? But he said, holy God, a holy ground this is. Oh, how about this? Going back to the very beginning of creation, or almost, on the seventh day after the creation, the Sabbath day, in Genesis 2, it says, by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work, and then God blessed the seventh day and made it holy. Is that day sinless and pure and righteous? Did he mean the rest of the 6 days was sinful, impure, and unrighteous? No. You see, these are only a few examples in the Bible talking about holiness. You know, from this, we can draw the conclusion. The holy or holiness does not necessarily mean sinless or pure or righteous. It means something else. So, what is holiness? What is holy? Well, the holiness actually means a state of being consecrated or sanctified. Big words. Consecrate and sanctify. What do they mean? Well, simply this. They both means, with a slight differences, by the way, but I'm not going into that. But it means set apart person or something from common or ordinary or profane to make them special or consider them special for the sacred purpose for God. That's what it means. So therefore, holiness or holy means the state of being set apart from common, ordinary, or profane to be made or considered as a special for God and his purpose. Is it clear? Holy means something set apart from ordinary, made special for God. The key word is set apart and special. So, from this definition, those scriptures we looked at, the holy God means like this. God is special. He is not common. He is someone above rest of the creation. He was set up as a special. Above all things. You know, this word, holy, God, the holy is describing his special nature and characteristics. That's why he is called Holy God, special one. How about this? God's holy people and holy nations, the Israelites, they were set apart from other nations and tribes as chosen people by God. It is a positional description. They used the word holy. How about the burning bush? It's a place which was special because there was God's presence there. Therefore, it was considered as a not common place. Do you know, after that, burning bush was not burning anymore. I think it returned to the common place. It's a ground that the sheep and goats went and poo. Yeah? But when God was there, it was special. See, it was out of ordinary. That's what the holy meant there. How about the seventh day after the... Hello? Yes. Yeah, God wanted pause after the 6 days of working. Yes. You know, he wanted to distinguish the seventh day from other 6 days. And that's why it was called holy. You see, from these, that we see holy means to distinguish something as a special, you know, sinless, the pure, righteous, got nothing to do with it. So, where has this holy as a sinless and pure and righteous preaching come from? Let's have a look how we become holy to begin with. And so we see why this misconception came into the church and Christianity. Well, holiness. How do we attain holiness? Be holy because I am holy. That word people use and put people in bondage, didn't they? So I have to make myself holy, set apart. No. That's not what the Bible says. You know, often we think we must strive to achieve this holiness in God's sight. But the truth is, we don't. Jesus makes us holy. It is not our effort to become holy. Word, become holy. You know, John 17, verse 19. Remember, I said, check the scriptures. John 17, verse 19 says, and I give myself as a holy sacrifice. That's what Jesus is saying, praying to the Father. For them, so they can be made holy by your truth. It does not say, so they make themselves holy. By my sacrifice, they will be made holy. Hebrews 10, verse 10, it says, and by that will, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Christ, Jesus Christ, once for all. 1 Corinthians 1, verse 30, Christ made us righteous with God, and he made us pure and holy and free from sin. Note, there's a distinction between holy, pure, and free from the sin. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 23 says, now may the God of peace make you holy in every way. Did you notice every way he's going to make us holy? Not just halfway, it's every way. God is not saying, God doesn't say, I will make you half holy, so the rest of the half you do. No, he said every way. He makes you holy. Leviticus 20, verse 8 in Old Testament even says, keep my decree and follow them. I am the Lord who makes you holy. Jesus makes us holy, makes you holy. Salvation in Jesus Christ is done by his grace, isn't it? You know, what Jesus has done on the cross is saving us from the wrath of God, which was induced by the sin which we inherited from the fallen world, from the beginning when Adam fell into the sin. That's why we are called born sinner. We could do nothing about it. But Jesus died on the cross to remove that, to change that. And he set us apart from this fallen world. By his blood and clothing us with his righteousness to distinguish us from the world and brought us into his kingdom. And this gives us the new status in God's sight and made us into new creation, made us something special for him. Sounds familiar? He set us apart from the world, which is sinful and fallen. Yeah? Made us special in God's sight. You are, every single one of you in Christ, you are very special. Keep that in mind, please. You are set apart from this fallen world. You are made holy by Jesus Christ. That's what those scriptures means. Nothing to do with our works and efforts or striving. But Jesus wanted, so he did it for us. And we are set apart. I tell you why. In Leviticus, it talks about, you know, the tabernacle and all the utensils, all the lampstands and tables and everything. God said, set them apart, make them holy. Those utensils cannot make themselves holy, can they? Was done by someone. Same with us. We are utensil in the kingdom of heaven. We are the God's spoons. Some of you are knife, very sharp. Yeah. Yeah, but anyway. God made us holy, set us apart. And the price was paid by the blood of Jesus. That's what the salvation is. Be holy because I am holy. 1 Peter. 1 verse 15 to 16. This is the most quoted verse regarding to the holiness, I would imagine. And this has been a preacher's delight, isn't it? To preach this. Be holy. Cleanse yourself. Feel good, though. You know, that's why everybody wants to be a preacher. Because it's so, I don't know, fun to telling people off. And we got such a protection called the lecterns. But anyway, and that gives a struggle for the Christians who hears a preaching. You know, if holiness is done by Christ, why did Peter tell us to be holy? As if it was our responsibility to attain this holiness. You know, have you ever thought about that? Why does he tell us to be holy if it was done by someone else? Please read 1 Peter 15 to 16 carefully. Peter says this, but just as he who called you is holy, means God is holy, special, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, be holy because I am holy. He said, be holy in everything you do. You do. See? Important part is all you do, you have to be holy. You know, he's talking about our actions, conduct, and attitude in our everyday life to be holy. You know, he's not talking about our status of being set apart here as special people of God. You know, he will talk about this in the next chapter. But at this particular verse, he's talking about our attitude to the life, that our conduct. You know, what Peter means in this verse is, we are set apart, the chosen by God, and taken away out of this world for him and for his purpose. We now belong to Christ, not belong to the world. That's why Jesus said, you are in the world, but not of the world, because you are set apart. And so Peter's saying, recognize this and grasp hold of who you are and live like one. You know, Peter tells us in the previous verse, it's chapter 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 to 14, that do not live like the way we used to live when we are conformed to the pattern of this world in ignorance. Now, you know better because you are set apart by the blood of Jesus. You are now special people. You don't belong there. You belong there. You know, Paul said exactly the same things in different words in Romans 12, 2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but transformed by the renewing of your mind. The holy living is about not living according to the world's way. That's what Peter is saying. Notice, you are special. God chose you, and God made you special. That's who you are. So live according to the way of Jesus. That's what he meant by be holy in all things you do. Because one that chose you, one that Jesus that chose you, that Jesus is different from the world. You know, this is about repentance from our way we used to have before Christ. You know. And this repentance, do you remember that I preached about the repentance a while ago? Revelation, realization, and action. This is the things. Realize who you are. You know, we are no longer belong to this fallen world, but are set apart by God in his grace and as a special people who belong to him. Therefore, we now live according to God's standard and not according to the world's standard. We are holy people, set apart special people of God, living according to the way of Jesus, who is not of this world. John 17, yeah? Thus, we are being holy because he is holy. You know what Christian means? Christian means be like Christ or followers of Christ. Now, we do not become holy by achieving perfection. You know, perfect sinlessness, purity, or righteousness in our lives, like some people believe. You know, some people believe, I'm not good enough to go to church. I'm not good enough to talk to God, pray to God. I'm not holy enough, they say. I'm not pure enough to ask for anything to, you know. Or I'm not righteous enough to lead the people to Jesus. No. Sinlessness, purity and righteousness are the result, the product of us being made holy. Holiness comes first before we are being sinless and pure in righteousness. Isn't it good? We can fulfill God's word and say, be holy because I am holy, without doing those struggles. I tell you what, if you've given your life to Christ, you are already holy. Jesus has taken away our sin, cleansed us as white as snow. We quote that, don't we? Yeah? And we also say that his righteousness clothes us. And we all know that's all done through his grace, not by our own effort or work or merit. That's a saving grace. You know, salvation means God made us holy, set us apart. That's what it means. You know, it's a bit like this. Imagine I adopt a little boy as my son. Yeah? Now, legally, he's my son. He could act like he is not my son if he wanted to. Yeah? But legally, he is my son. He didn't become my son because he acted like my son. He is my son already. Peter's saying this. You are adopted to God as his son, for example, well, as his child. Act like his child. Okay, you can still act sinfully or falling down and doing the wrong things, acting like not his child. But legally, in heaven, you are still his child. So when you realize you are his child, then you act like his child. In other words, if he didn't adopt you, just a kid on the street, let's say, however he act like his child, legally he isn't, isn't he? Your neighbor, maybe you've got a really, really good kid in your neighborhood and treat him like a son, but actually go to registration office or wherever, legally he's not your son. So, who we are comes first, and then what we do aligns to it. You see, through this realization of the grace of God working in our lives, we align ourselves, our thinking, the attitude, the action, to our position in God. That's what the Bible is telling us. Work out your salvation. You know, work out salvation, strange word, but some people think that you have to work to get the salvation or approval of God. No, this is what it means. Work out your salvation means work out your life to align with your status in God. You know, we may still stumble and fall, I say. You know, that's our weakness as human beings, and God understands that. Even Apostle Paul said that in Romans 7, said that there are things I want to do, I should do, but I don't. And things I shouldn't do, I still do. What shall I do? It's not me, because I don't want to do it, but it's a sin in me, does it? Who could save me from this wretched state, you know, position? And then said, thank God. Thank God and his grace. Jesus Christ saves me. Made me set apart. Made me special. So don't feel guilty when you fall. You can always stand up again. If you want to crawl, you can crawl. But I like to stand up and walk with my own feet. See, in God's eyes, we are already holy people because of what the Lord Jesus did for us on the cross. This is who you are, who we are. In his eyes, we are already holy and accepted. You know, we cannot attain more holiness than what Jesus has given us. You know that quote, you think you're holy, eh? That's grammatically, is that right? Grammatically incorrect. You can, I believe, and then scripture backs up, you know, there is no holier. You see, Jesus made us holy. If there is measurement of holiness, it means we are saying that Jesus did not, well, you know, what Jesus did on the cross, that his death and his shed blood was not enough to make us holy, special enough. And that's why we are saying, if we can be more holy, isn't it? You know, there is no measurement of holiness. You are either holy or not holy. Either you are set apart or not set apart. Or you belong to Jesus or not belong to Jesus. So next time you hear someone tell you, you think you are holier than the rest of us, said, that's not right. Well, this realization of who we are and who he helps us to work out our salvation. You know, I said, being holy is the works of God. But living in that holiness, the position, the status of who you are, is our part. But good thing is, we don't have to do it by ourselves. God is always there to help us. You know, when you got weakness and shortfalls, God is always there to help us to overcome that. And help us to align ourselves and everything we do, our actions and thinking and attitude, he will help us to align that as long as we are willing. And then we can live as a holy people. So, are you getting this, yeah? Making something clear. I hope this will lighten your heart, the mind. We are made holy by Jesus Christ. So next time, when you hear the preacher said, as you are Christian, you must live holy. And you must be holy. I said, yeah, praise God that I am already holy because what Jesus Christ did on the cross. And now God is helping me to live, to align with that. If someone says to you, you think you are holier than the rest of us, tell them, what you are saying doesn't make sense. I am holy, yes, because Jesus Christ made me holy. How about you? You see, we confess Jesus Christ taken away all our sins from past, present, and future, don't we? But at the same time, we don't believe we are pure enough, righteous enough, clean enough, sinless enough. You know, that's the bondage that the people put on us over the years. Okay, live right and live righteously and live pure is important, of course. But it must come. Our motivation for the living must come from the realization of who we are. And when we realize who we are in Christ Jesus, we want to live like him. This is what it is. How do we know how to live like him? In there. If you want to live like Jesus, as you are set apart as a special people for God, you need to know where he lived. And it's all in there. That's why I encourage you to read the Bible. Well, so that's truth about holiness. Who we are in Christ Jesus. Don't take my words. Like as it is, as I said at the beginning, please look and find out for yourself. You know, once you realize that, it's so good. It's so good. You know, life becomes such a fun, isn't it? Well, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You made us holy. You set us apart because you wanted us to be special in you, Lord. And thank you, Jesus. You made it possible. And you made it for us. And God, I thank you, Lord, that you are there to help us to align with who we are in you. So, Holy Spirit, I pray, each one of us who heard this word, Lord, you just confirm that with your word. I believe this is the truth that you wanted to believe, you wanted to reveal. And God, you said the truth will set us free. So Father God, I thank you for today. And this week, we believe that you speak to us because you consider us special, especially dear to your heart. And we want everybody in this world to come to know his love. And they to know them, for them to know they are special in your sight, each one of them. Help us, Lord, to bring in the good news. And Lord, this week, I believe you speak to us, each one of us. So Father God, I praise you, Lord, and thank you, Lord. And then from Akradai Community Church, we bless you this week. Amen.